Chapter 8 of Aristopia by Castello, Newton, Holford. The site for the town was selected a few hundred yards above the mouth of Rock Creek, where the ground is high enough to be free from malaria, while the hill is not inconveniently steep. Springs of pure water were near at hand. Several tents had been brought, and with these and tarpaulins and boards, convenient shelters were soon set up on a little clearing made for the purpose. Then began the work of felling trees for house timber. Of course, the first land to be cleared was the space for the village. After that, the trees were felled on a spot near the mouth of the creek, well adapted for tillage, so as to be clearing a field with the same labour that procured building material. It was decided to build the first square of the village of 30 cabins, 15 by 20 feet, around a square 300 feet on each side. The intervals between the houses were to be filled with a stockade. All the doors and windows were to be on the inside of the square, while in the outer walls were to be no openings except loopholes for muskets, for it was determined to make the village a fort, trusting nothing to the savages. Though the Nacotch tanks were at present friendly, the Massawomecks might come, and Ralph Morton knew that barbarian nature is fickle and inconstant. The cabins at Jamestown had been thatched with reeds, and thatch was quite a common roofing for English country houses, but Ralph had seen in the Jamestown conflagration the dangers of such roofs. It was decided to make the roofs of shakes or shingles about 3 feet long, split from straight-grained timber. A supply of froze had been brought over for splitting shakes. In fact, Ralph's forethought had supplied everything. His experience in logging at Jamestown enabled him to invent a truck for hauling logs. It had two wheels placed much closer together than those of an ordinary wagon, so as to pass more easily between trees and stumps. The axle was like the drum of a windlass, so that a log could be loaded by drawing it up with a chain wound up by turning the axle with spikes. The chain was fastened to the log between the large end of the log and the middle, leaving the small end to drag on the ground. The larger logs were split in two, thus economizing material and making the work of raising the logs upon the walls lighter. It was found that they could be split more easily with a charge of blasting powder than with wedges. The cabins were supplied with stone fireplaces, building stone being close at hand, very broad, as wood was plentiful. The chimneys were made of sticks, thickly covered with clay to keep them from burning. As glass was then scarce and dear, the colony used little of it in their windows, which were mostly made of oiled muslin. In that age, people procured light in their houses mostly by leaving the doors open, except in stormy weather. Ralph Morton supervised the work with constant care and good judgment, apportioning the labour of felling trees, cutting and notching the logs, splitting the shakes, raising the logs, etc., among the men, so that no strength would be wasted. For hauling the material there were two span of horses and two yoke of oxen, with two wagons and three logging trucks. As many men as could work without getting in each other's way were put upon one house to finish it as soon as possible. Until the first house was finished, the women and children slept on board the vessel. Afterward they slept in the houses. Until houses enough for all to sleep in were finished, a guard of three men, assisted by three mastiffs, was kept at night. It was observed that the Indians were much afraid of these great dogs. Four small cannon were planted, one at each corner of the fort. The sailors were kept at work while the vessel stayed. A good many of the Indians also assisted in such work as they could do. It has been supposed that Indian men cannot be induced to do manual labour, but this is not the case. They assisted in loading the ships of the first English traders with sassafras wood on the Atlantic coast. In the far northwest I have seen them working as lumbermen, and in the far southwest as railroad graders, but they will not work continuously. 3 consecutive days is the very longest time they will labour. Morton would not trust the Indians in the village at night. He made them withdraw to their camp before dark. As the Indians learned the great value of hoes in cultivating their corn, their women were glad to help the white men clear their fields, taking hoes in payment. A squaw would willingly work 3 days for a narrow hoe that cost Morton 15 pence. The Indians had heretofore used the shoulder blades of elks and bears for hoes and shovels. The Indians also supplied the colony with fresh meat in exchange for ornamental trinkets. Seines had been provided, with which plenty of fish were easily taken from the river nearby. When the houses were completed and the stockade was built, work was directed to clearing and planting a field. Indian corn, beans, peas, pumpkins, and Irish potatoes were planted. The last vegetable was as yet little known in England, but Ralph Morton was quick to see its value as a food plant, and had brought some tubers for planting. The flora remained with the colony about 6 weeks, that the sailors might assist in building the houses and loading the ship. Part of a cargo, consisting of stave bolts split from the best white oak trees, sassafras and cedar, was loaded, and the vessel returned to England for another load of colonists and goods. Besides the horses and oxen, there had been brought out 3 good cows, 6 young pigs, and 12 chickens. As the settlement was now in fact a village, it needed a name. Ralph proposed to call it Columbia, but his brothers importuned him to call it Mortonia, and so it was named. Soon after his arrival, Ralph visited his mine and found it undisturbed. He did nothing more about it until the houses were built and the field was planted. Then he set men at work to build a house over the mine. The foundation of the building was made of large stones set in cement. This foundation was raised to a level, it being on a steep hillside, and the rest of the building was made of logs about 1 foot thick. The roof was of shed form, sloping with the hill, made of 2-inch oak plank firmly spiked on. The small door was of heavy oak plank. There was only 1 window, narrow and guarded with iron bars. The room was about 15 feet square and 8 feet high. A large number of men were kept at work on the building to finish it as soon as possible. During the time it was being built, Ralph slept every night over the mine on a bed of pine boughs, bearskins, and blankets. The workmen had a camp nearby. Of course, the men were curious to know what the building was for, and it was hinted that it was for a prison. Then they were curious to know why a prison should be built there, nearly 3 miles from the town. The whites considering it a prison, and the Indians being informed that it was bad medicine, no one was likely to try to get into it, and Ralph's object was to prevent anyone from discovering the mine inside. Henry and Charles Morton had been informed of the existence of the mine under the strongest bond of secrecy. Ralph had refused to inform his other brothers and John Summers of the source of his wealth, but let them infer from the legend on the gold bars that he had been in at the capture of a Spanish West Indian carrack, something which most Englishmen still considered by no means a reprehensible proceeding, although there had been peace between England and Spain for several years. The spring and summer passed without any such epidemic as Ralph Morton somewhat apprehended. There was some mild temporary sickness from change of climate, and some from ordinary causes, but there had been no deaths. The location was high and healthful, the water pure and cool, the food good and plentiful, and everything had been ordered with so much forethought that not only was disaster, but even discomfort avoided. The crops ripened and added to the colonists' store. Of course, in the crude, freshly cleared soil, they were not so good as next year's crops should be, but they were fair. During the latter part of the summer, the colonists had leisure to build another square of cabins for the new immigrants whose arrival was expected, and to provide a large supply of stave bolts, sassafras, and cedar for loading the Flora as soon as she should arrive and discharge her cargo. In August, Ralph and his two brothers went to work in the mine to get out more gold. The quartz about the mass of gold was dug out all around for a depth of 2 feet or more. It was then found that the gold filled a crevice in the quartz in a solid sheet about 6 inches thick and from 6 to 8 feet long, the length in the same direction as that of the quartz dike. A small hole being dug to a depth of 10 feet, it was found that the mass extended still farther downward. Ralph was then assured of wealth enough to carry out his design of founding a nation. It was much labour to saw the blocks of gold out of this mass. 1,000 pounds avoirdupois was got out and cast into bars in the moulds with the Spanish legends, which, with the crucibles, Ralph had brought with him. End of chapter 8. Chapter 9 of Aristopia by Castello, Newton, Holford. The Flora arrived again about the middle of September, bringing 92 immigrants, of whom 18 were women and 24 children. Among the men were 2 carpenters, 1 blacksmith, and 1 tailor. There was also a young physician. Hitherto Ralph Morton had acted as physician to the colony. There was, too, a clergyman, a young man who, without powerful connections, had despaired of getting a living in England, and had concluded to trust Providence in America. He had been informed that he could expect no tithes nor anything for his religious services except voluntary contributions, but that he would be paid a fair salary for teaching the children of the colony as long as he chose, if he would agree to teach until another teacher could be procured. His theology was of a somewhat mild type, rather inclining to a doctrine of love than delighting to deal damnation to heretics, as was the fashion and the passion of the times in theology. Ralph Morton was very glad of this, and encouraged the pastor all he could. It must not be supposed that the colony had gone without religious services all this time. In such a body of Englishmen at that time, there were always to be found men able and willing to lead in such services as reading the liturgy and the Bible, singing psalms and praying. A leader in all things else, Ralph Morton was a very modest follower here. Among the first immigrants to the Jamestown colony were 6 tailors, several perfumers and barbers, and 4 goldsmiths, jewellers, and refiners. With the exception of the 1 tailor, there were no such people in the Mortonia colony. But there was 1 artisan on the Flora many years ahead of any of his guild in any other colony of America, a printer. The reason of his coming thus early was that Ralph Morton had determined to reform the English language in spelling and grammar, at least so far as it was to be used in his new nation. In his study of several languages, he had often cause to wonder at the perverse folly of people in retaining so tenaciously the bewildering irregularities of their grammar, when regularity would have been so much easier and better. He determined to make the conjugations of all verbs, the comparison of all adjectives, and the plurals of all nouns quite regular in all the printing done in his new nation. The spelling of English of that day was a marvel of confusion. There was no dictionary or other authority or standard of spelling. Although the spelling of a large number of words was somewhat fixed in a barbarous and bungling way, most words were spelled according to the caprices of the writers, and it was no uncommon thing to find the same word spelled 2 or 3 different ways in the same paragraph. Then, too, the U's and the V's took each other's places in the most bewildering manner. Ralph had made a very careful study of the sounds of the language. He saw how utterly inadequate to represent all those sounds were the 26 letters of the Roman alphabet. The only hope of a rational spelling was to invent new characters. So he invented 11 new characters, both print and script, 6 vowel and 5 consonant letters. The new vowel letters were mostly small changes in the old letters to represent the cognate sounds of those old letters. In the old vowel letters, the principal rule was to use each one to represent that sound which it most frequently represented in the common spelling. Then each letter must always represent one and the same sound, and each sound be invariably represented by the same letter. This would give order, system, and regularity, instead of the present disorder, confusion, and chaos. The letters Q and X and the long S were rejected as useless. Ralph had ordered from Venice, where were then the best typecutters, the dies for his new characters in all ordinary sizes of type. The type were to be cast in Holland for greater convenience of shipping. In this cargo was only £100 of the size now called Great Primer. This was intended for printing elementary reading books. Ralph had spent considerable time in his ocean voyages writing 2 well-graded reading books for beginners, lessons of short familiar words and simple ideas. No such sensible books then existed. With the type was a press. There were also all other necessary materials for printing, including plenty of paper. The printer, who was also a bookbinder, was immediately set at work on a child's primer. The greater part of the colonists now in Mortonia, and those to come, spoke some uncouth dialect of English, and few of them could read, so they were not likely to make objection to the innovation. The only objections came from the teachers and the few educated persons, but these were so much under Ralph Morton's influence and so dependent on him that they yielded, and when they became accustomed to the innovation were its most zealous supporters. As before said, the first colonists were all employés of Ralph Morton. He had paid them from the day of their embarking such wages as they were accustomed to receive in England, considering the food and lodgings furnished them. On the arrival of the second company, however, Ralph called them all together and proposed to them to form a new Commonwealth, better than the world had ever seen before. The opportunity in a virgin world was before them. The means, he solemnly assured them, he held in his hands. He would devote all those means and his life to establishing such a commonwealth, a commonwealth not a mockery of the name, as England was, where the rich idlers revelled in luxury on the proceeds of the toil of the wretched and drudging poor. In an ideal republic, after it was established, the governor should be chosen by the people for a stated term and be removable. But this commonwealth was first to be established, and for such establishment, and to ensure the proper application of the vast means he held ready, it was necessary that he should be governor for life. What he had already done in bringing them all over free and maintaining them so far was but a grain of sand on the seashore to what he would do. But they must adopt the system of government he proposed. He was willing to spend his wealth and his life for no other. He had drawn up a constitution and a code of laws. The code might be added to and altered by the representatives of the people or the people themselves, but the constitution was not to be altered without the consent of the governor. Ralph Morton had spent much thought on a model commonwealth, and brought to the task a wide knowledge of history in all ages, a mind of powerful grasp, deep insight and long foresight, and an unselfish devotion to the good of his fellows. It was the sudden springing up of ideas inspired by this devotion that led him to conceal the existence of the mine, and not the cunning and calculating selfishness which such a course might seem to indicate. One of the books which had given Ralph Morton many ideas of a model Commonwealth was Thomas More's Utopia. This book has long been misunderstood and misrepresented. It has generally been spoken of as the scheme of a mild lunatic for upsetting all the good old order of society and instituting in its place something as impossible for human beings with their sinful nature to attain without first dying as it would be for those same gross mortals to live without first dying in the Elysian fields above the sunset clouds. In fair truth, More's book contained only the sane, wise ideas of a man centuries ahead of his age, a lover of humanity more than of self. One by one, as the centuries wore away, his wild imaginings, as they seemed to be, became the accomplished facts of history. Human nature was found to be capable of better things than bigoted theologians or sneering cynics thought possible. That great seer's splendid visions yet unfulfilled are no more impossible than what has been accomplished. But let us hope that the accomplishment will be accelerated so that a work equal to that of past centuries may be done in a few future years. Thomas More spent his childhood in the household of Cardinal Morton, a brother of one of Ralph Morton's ancestors, which fact perhaps helped to attract Ralph's attention to More's work, where his precocious ability was a constant marvel. At Oxford his career did not belie the old cardinal's prophecy of his future greatness. One of the most religious of men, even to asceticism, bigots called him a free thinker. Entering Parliament at 26, he was instrumental in the rejection of a heavy subsidy demanded by Henry VII. Leaving Parliament, he became a prominent lawyer. Under Henry VIII, he was a trusted counsellor and a diplomatist. It was in one of his diplomatic missions to Holland that, as his story goes, he met the ancient mariner, a companion of Amerigo Vespucci, who had discovered, in the depths of the virgin continent, the Republic of Utopia. In Utopia, human virtue, which theologians esteem as naught, had attained the true ends of society, liberty, equality, fraternity, and security. In England, More truthfully said, quote, "The whole of society is but a conspiracy of the rich against the poor. The rich are ever striving to pare away something further from the daily wages of the poor by private fraud and even by public law, so that the wrong already existing, for it is a wrong that those from whom the state derives most benefit should receive least reward, is made yet greater by the law of the state. The rich devise every means by which they may, in the first place, secure to themselves what they have amassed by wrong, and then take to their own use and profit, at the lowest possible price, the labour of the poor. And so soon as the rich decide on adopting these devices in the name of the public, then they become law. The toiling poor are reduced to a life so wretched that even a beast's life seems enviable." Turning from this pitiful picture of the English labourer of the 16th century, from the horrible social tyranny that found expression in every page of the English statute book, More tells us that in Utopia the aim of legislation is the true social, industrial, moral, and intellectual welfare of the whole community, of which the labour class is the most important. As work was compulsory with all, no class of idlers called noble and gentle living on their stealthy robberies of the workers, as in England, the hours of labour could be shortened to 9, which would have seemed short indeed to the English labourer of that age. the hours thus saved from manual labour were devoted to the cultivation of the mind. To this end, a thorough system of public education was maintained. In England, few labourers could read. In Utopia, every child was well educated. The physical side of life in Utopia was as attractive as the mental. While in England, in More's day, the common people dwelt in, quote, low and homely cottages and poor shepherd huts, made at all adventure of every rude piece of timber that came first to hand, with mud walls and ridged roofs thatched over with straw, end quote. Nests of squalor, filth, and pestilence, in Utopia the houses were spacious, well-lighted, airy, comfortable, and clean. Quote, the streets were 20 feet broad, end quote. In English towns of that day they were not half that. Quote, the houses backed by spacious gardens and curiously builded after a gorgeous and gallant sort, with their stories one after another. They keep the wind out of their windows with glass, for it is there much used, and sometimes also with fine linen cloth dipped in oil or amber, for by this means more light cometh in, and the wind is better kept out. End quote. In More's days the window of the English cottage was literally a wind-hole in the wall. In England, the petty thief received the same punishment as the murderer, death for almost every crime. In Utopia, the object of legal punishment was as much to reform the criminal as to protect society. In fact, More in Utopia anticipates all those reforms in the treatment of criminals which distinguish the 19th from the brutal and savage 16th century. In Utopia was that complete religious toleration which was looked for in vain in Europe until the middle of the 18th century. In Utopia there was political liberty, a complete democracy, while England, under the Tudor tyrants, was fast losing the little political liberty she ever had. Under the cover of Utopia, More penned a scathing denunciation of the tyranny of Henry and his servile judges, and this, too, within the very court of the king and under the eye of his ministers. No wonder that the author of Utopia paid for his devotion to liberty and humanity with his head on Tower Hill. End of chapter 9. Chapter 10 of Aristopia by Castello, Newton, Holford. One of the most effective means by which the few and idle rich oppress the many toiling poor is by the monopoly of land. Ralph Morton's reading had shown him this truth, illustrated by the history of all civilized peoples. But he had before his eyes in England so flagrant an example that it needed no reading to enforce the truth. That great robber, William the Norman, had parcelled out the land of England among his robber favourites, who had subdivided them among their favourites with the burden of some conditions. And so on, downward went the division, the burdens all the while increasing, till at last they fell with crushing force on the poor tillers of the soil and the equally unfortunate disinherited, driven altogether from the soil. So horrible an example of a great mass of people robbed of their natural rights seemed, by the force of custom and the decorous forms of law, so right and proper that only here and there adown the centuries could be heard a voice like Thomas More's protesting against it. Morton was sure that sooner or later America would be parcelled out among King's favourites just as Europe had been, and with like wretched results. He determined to prevent such results so far as was in his power. He could see no way to do it effectually while allowing private ownership of land. To limit the amount of land one man might own presented insuperable difficulties. How could a just limit be fixed? 20 acres of agricultural land might be no more than one man and his family needed, but 20 acres in a city, or on which a city might grow up, would so enrich a man and make him master of his fellows that he could oppress and corrupt them by thousands. 1,000 acres of mountain land fit only for grazing might be none too much for a family, but 1,000 acres of good agricultural land would make a man a landlord with a horde of slavish tenants. So Morton's constitution provided that, in the Commonwealth, there should be no private ownership of land, including waters, forests, and mines, except the title he had acquired from the Virginia Company, and the title he expected to acquire from the king to other and broader lands. This title he was to hold during his life as a means of ensuring the carrying out of his views. But although the ultimate title of the land rested in him, the practical ownership should be in the Commonwealth, from whom the citizens should hold the land. No agricultural land should be leased for longer than 15 years at one lease, and no urban land for longer than 50 years. These leases could be renewed so that a family could make a home and have a security for its continued possession, something which private ownership does not give to the nominal owner, as millions of poor men have found to their sorrow. The Commonwealth might, until it needed the rent for revenue, allow its members land rent-free, but no more to one man than he and his family actually tilled or used without hired help. The next great instrument for enriching a few at the expense of the many was, Ralph Morton saw, the traffic in merchandise. No other thing except monopoly of land could so encourage a selfish and greedy disposition as this traffic. Next to usury, it is the delight of that strange vampire race, the Hebrews. The merchant class in England had then acquired but little of the tremendous power it afterward attained. It needed the foresight of Thomas More or Ralph Morton to see the danger to an ideal society, a human brotherhood, in this traffic. So Morton's constitution provided that all traffic in merchandise in the Commonwealth should be carried on by the public agency. A bureau of trade appointed by the governor should import and export all goods. Public stores should be established, with storekeepers and clerks appointed by the governor, in which goods should be sold to the inhabitants of the Commonwealth, and their produce bought for resale or export. The people might exchange their commodities with each other, or sell them to private persons, but no person should buy to sell again. The profits on the purchase and sale of goods should not be excessive, and should be public revenue for public expenses. In Ralph Morton's mind were vaguely outlined plans for making all sorts of machinery run by water power do the work of millions of human hands. If a few men could obtain possession of the waterfalls, and by wealth somehow acquired, could own the machines, they would become the masters of both the workmen who attended the machines and those who were displaced by them. So the Constitution carefully guarded the waterfalls from private ownership and provided for the public ownership of factories run by water power. In these provisions for the public manufacture and sale of goods, Morton builded better than he knew. Not even his genius, nor any other less than inspired, could have foreseen the evils which a manufacturing and trading age would produce. The evils of shoddy goods, of articles made for sale and not for use and useless, of fatal defects glossed over by the manufacturers and hidden by lying salesmen, of goods deliberately damaged a dime's worth to the user that the manufacturer might save a cent, of deadly poisons in food, drink, and drugs. Yes, in wearing apparel and the paper of bedrooms, the health of thousands ruined and their lives endangered, that manufacturers and tradesmen might make a few cents from each victim. And the deepest pity of it all is that the most frequent and most injured victims are the poorest, most needy, and most helpless members of society. as another guard against the undue accumulation of wealth in the hands of individuals, the law of primogeniture was abolished. A deceased person's property was to be equally divided between his heirs, his wife, or, if a woman, her husband, and children. If any of the children were dead, leaving children of their own, such grandchildren to inherit their parents' share per stirpes and not per capita. If there were no wife or husband or descendants, the property to go to the parents or grandparents of deceased. If no such ancestors, it was to escheat to the Commonwealth, for collateral relatives could not take. No person should leave more than $10,000, about £2,000, to one heir. If his property amounted to more than that sum for each heir, the balance was to escheat to the Commonwealth. As no person then in the colony, except the Mortons, expected to have £2,000, nor even dreamed of having so much as to leave £2,000 to each of his children, no objection could be made by the settlers to this provision. This provision could not be evaded by a will or a donatio causa mortis, deathbed gift. Roads and bridges must be public property. No private toll road or bridge would be allowed. A code of laws should be proposed by the governor as soon after his election as practicable, and adopted or rejected by a vote of the colonists at a public meeting. After that, laws were to be enacted by a congress elected by the people, but no act of congress should be a law unless approved by the governor, or, if vetoed by him, unless repassed by a two-thirds vote of congress. To prevent too frequent changes of laws, Congress should have but one session in 3 years, unless called together by the governor on account of an emergency. As representatives would sometimes misrepresent the people, provisions were made by which the people themselves could initiate legislation, and certain classes of laws of a radical or fundamental character were to be submitted to a vote of the whole people. It is needless to recite the details of the constitution relating to the necessary officers of the Commonwealth, executive, legislative, and judicial, and their election or appointment. The electors were to be every male citizen over 20 years old, unconvicted of felony, and all widows being citizens over 30 years old. Other women over 20 could vote for school officers. Morton considered these provisions an entering wedge for greater privileges for women. After the first day of January 1612, any person not on or before that date a resident of Mortonia must reside in the colony 5 years to acquire the rights of a citizen and elector. Any amendment to the constitution must be first passed by a two-thirds vote of Congress, and then receive a majority vote of the electors of the Commonwealth before taking effect. But no amendment could be adopted during the life of the first governor without his approval. The constitution was submitted to the members of the colony and adopted without change, without a murmur of dissent. And Ralph Morton was named governor for life. The code of criminal laws Governor Morton proposed differed radically from the laws then in force in England, where most crimes were punished with death, although death in different forms, from beheading and hanging to burning at the stake and boiling in oil. Mutilation, such as cutting off the right hand and ears, slitting the nostrils, boring the tongue, and branding, was common. The so-called crimes of blasphemy, witchcraft, sorcery, and idolatry were punished by burning to death. The Morton Code proclaimed that the object of punishment was to protect, not to revenge, society, that where possible it should contemplate the reformation, not the destruction, of the criminal, that savage and bloody punishments and tortures were brutalizing to the whole people, and worthy of savage and heathen, not of civilized and Christian people. No crime except murder and arson of a dwelling at night was to be punished with death, and that death in no form except hanging. Other crimes were to be punished in proportion to their enormity. The code was silent as to witchcraft, blasphemy, sorcery, and idolatry. Though the people wondered at so mild a code, they adopted it by a large majority. In the minority was the clergyman. Mild as he was, he thought it well to burn some people. Foreseeing the danger to the colony from the savages armed with firearms, the Morton Code provided that any person convicted of furnishing to an Indian any firearm or gunpowder, or teaching any Indian the use of firearms, should suffer imprisonment at hard labour, in chains until a prison should be provided, for 3 years, and then be banished to the West Indies. If he returned, he was to suffer death. Severe penalties were provided for selling swords or knives with blades more than 3 inches long or with sharp points, or axes or hatchets to Indians. Every firearm in the possession of a resident of the colony was to be registered, and he might be called on to produce it at any time. The sale of gunpowder was to be recorded, like the sale of poison. The Morton Code provided for public schools for all the children of the colony, making attendance compulsory. All teaching in these schools was to be in the English language. End of chapter 10. Chapter 11 of Aristopia by Castello Newton Holford. Houses had been provided for the shelter of the newcomers and were ready for them on their arrival. A schoolhouse, by far the largest and best house in the colony, was immediately built. The walls were of hewn logs, chinked with stones and mortar instead of sticks and clay, and an abundance of glass windows were provided. Those who wished to go to farming on their own account immediately had land allotted to them, 10 acres to each man. It was so arranged that even those who had no means could go to work on their fields and find support until they could raise a crop. As making the land ready for cultivation would add considerably to its value, it was arranged that the farmer should be allowed a certain amount per acre to be paid by the Commonwealth for the land he cleared. Then he could sell to the Commonwealth for shipment to England all the stave bolts and charcoal he could make, and all the sassafras and cedar timber he could cut on his land and bring to the river's edge. Thus, while clearing his field, he could be earning a living. If this should not be sufficient, he was to have some credit at the Commonwealth store. This store was stocked by the governor as a gift to the Commonwealth to begin with. In the last cargo, no horses, but 10 yoke of oxen had been brought over, oxen being better adapted for rough work in a new country than horses, as well as being cheaper in price and less expensive to feed. 6 yoke were sold, one to each farmer who was able to buy, and the rest were kept to be hired to those who needed to use them, and for public use. 6 goats were brought over. It was not deemed advisable to try sheep-raising until larger clearings should be made, but the bold and active goats could avoid and beat off the wolves. 7 young pigs and 7 geese and ducks were also brought on the last voyage. As it was observed that crops did not grow at the extreme edge of a clearing, Morton persuaded the farmers to make their clearings 4 together, each 4 at the place where the corners of their 4 lots joined, so that the open spaces would be larger than if each farmer made a separate clearing. Thus also 4 men could work near each other with more security against savages. Charcoal has been mentioned as one of the products of the colonists. Though at this time pit coal, or sea coal as it was then called, was considerably used in London, it was unpopular, and its use had been prohibited by Parliament. Charcoal was then, and for a generation later, universally used for smelting iron. Wood was becoming scarce in England, and timber for shipbuilding was in great demand. The use of any wood fit for shipbuilding in making charcoal was prohibited. Under these circumstances, charcoal could be profitably made for export by the colonists of Mortonia, where wood was a thing to be gotten rid of in clearing fields. Some men skilled in making charcoal came in the last supply, and the art was easily learned by all. The colonists learned from the Indians to expedite the clearing of land by girdling the large trees, that is, cutting off a wide ring of bark around the trunks. A well-girdled tree would never leaf again, and in a few years would decay. Through its bare branches the sunlight and air could come to the growing crops below. But the colonists saved the best of the large trees for lumber, girdling only the gnarly, twisted, and unsound ones. Within 2 weeks of her arrival in September, the Flora sailed again for Europe. Henry Morton, with £1,000 avoirdupois of gold, went in her. To make it appear that the gold came from Spanish America, the Flora took only part of a cargo of timber and some furs, and sailed to Cuba, where she completed her cargo with sugar, and sailed for Amsterdam. Ralph Morton sent instructions to his agents to buy immediately 4 more ships of not less than 200 tons each, or, if they could not be bought promptly, to charter them until that number could be bought. 5 more of 300 tons each were to be built on a model furnished by Ralph Morton himself. They were to be considerably longer and lower than the model then in vogue. Thus they would have increased capacity, would pitch less, and drift less to seaward during contrary winds. English shipbuilders were then the best in the world, and they were rapidly improving both in the workmanship and size of their vessels. James Morton was to make his headquarters in Bristol, then the second city in England. Edward Morton was to go to Holland, with headquarters at Amsterdam. Numerous agents were to be appointed to procure emigrants in Holland, Denmark, and Germany. The agents were to receive a premium for each desirable emigrant furnished, and suffer a penalty for each emigrant they sent of a prohibited class. No criminals, beggars, or habitual paupers were to be sent. No cripples nor permanent invalids, unless they belonged to the family of some emigrant to Mortonia bound for their support. No person over 50 years old would be accepted, unless such person was the parent of some emigrant to Mortonia bound to the parent's support. No person suffering from, or known or suspected to be infected with, smallpox or other plague was to be shipped. There were at that time in Holland a number of English emigrants called Brownists, who had left their native land because they could not make all England adopt their religious notions, and had been roughly used for their sublime efforts to do so. Not understanding the Dutch language, they could not hope to bring the Dutch nation into their narrow theological path, so they lived quietly in Holland, a little theocratic community, ruled absolutely by their preachers in all such minor matters as the rather liberal Dutch government did not meddle with. Morton's agents in Holland were instructed not to send any of these men to Mortonia, as the governor knew well what firebrands they would be in his colony. The Indians still supplied the colonists of Mortonia with most of their meat. It was strictly forbidden to private members of the Commonwealth to trade with the Indians. Such trading was to be done by the officials and public storekeepers as public business. Morton adopted the close dealing of Captain Smith rather than the lavish prodigality of Newport. He did not think equity required him to give an Indian beads which cost 10 shillings in London for a pelt worth 10 shillings in London, or anything on that basis. It was sufficient if he gave the Indian for the skin what the savage thought the skin worth, in beads of a value estimated by the savage rather than by the white man. It may be thought that the Indian was like a child or a weak-minded person, incapable of estimating values and not to be allowed to cheat himself, but Morton found him quite shrewd enough in his own sphere, and knowing quite well what a thing was worth to himself, if he did not know what it was worth to the white man. At the approach of winter, great numbers of wild geese and ducks came down from the north, and the colonists were able to kill a great many of these fowls. They found also in this new world great quantities of wild fruits, which added much zest to their fare. Beginning about the end of May, there were strawberries, then in succession dewberries, raspberries, blackberries, plums, grapes, and lastly persimmons, or parchments as they were then called, lasting until far into the winter. Nuts in variety were also plentiful. When the Flora sailed, she took back letters from most of the colonists to their relatives and friends in England. Few, if any, failed to extol the conditions of life in Mortonia and urge others to come. As soon as possible, the governor set a number of men at work to build a mill. It was found that Rock Creek had sufficient volume and fall for an ordinary mill, and that one could be built more easily here than on the river. But Morton intended to build much greater mills, to be run with the great power which the falls in the river could furnish. The mill was made both for grinding grain and sawing lumber. Sawmills were then unknown in England. One, which was built near London in 1633, was torn down by a mob of workmen who feared that the innovation would deprive them of work. The people of Mortonia, however, saw such a vast amount of work before them waiting to be done that they welcomed any help from water power. Morton had carefully designed the machinery of the sawmill and had it made in England. Soon the rocky hills of the lonely creek resounded with the hum of machinery and the growling of the great saw tearing its way through the logs, doing the work of many men in the old way. The contemplation of this work afforded the liveliest pleasure to Ralph Morton. In March 1611, the Flora arrived for the third time at Mortonia. A majority of the immigrants she brought this time were women and children. All the colonists who had come on the other two trips, leaving families in England, had them brought out on the third voyage. Also, some unmarried women came, some of them as dependent relatives of the other immigrants, others induced to come with the understood, if not avowed, object of finding husbands in America. Soon the newly acquired ships of the governor began to arrive, bringing a great many immigrants. With increased force, men were set at work to dig a long mill race, bringing water from above the little falls of the Potomac to the head of tidewater, where, with a great volume and ample fall of water, large sawmills were built. Logs could then be run down the river from above by the current, brought from below on the river by towing or the incoming tide, and floated out of Rock Creek. Lumber then became an important article of export, selling at a good profit in the English markets in competition with hand-sawn lumber. It was more than 30 years before the colonists of Mortonia had any competition in mill-sawn lumber, and then it came from the shrewd Puritans of New England. With abundance of mill-sawn lumber, a new style of architecture replaced the log cabins chinked with sticks and clay. Frame houses, much better looking and more cleanly than the cabins, became the ordinary dwellings. An improvement in dwellings is certain to improve the character of a people. The inside walls of these houses were of lath and plaster, the laths fastened to the frame with pegs, nails being then handmade and expensive, a small size costing in London 5d/100, and 5d was about half a day's wages of the workmen who made them. Nails were mostly made, however, by women and children. In Mortonia, as in every community not purely communistic, a currency was necessary, although a less amount was necessary in Mortonia than in other communities of its population, owing to the traffic being conducted by the public agency. the colonists could take their produce to the stores and in exchange get credit on the store books on which they could purchase goods. But still some money was necessary. Morton had no authority to coin money. Partly for this reason, and partly because he had some ideas of his own, centuries ahead of his age, on the subject of currency, he determined to make money of paper bills. He saw that in civilized commerce, money is only a set of counters with which an instantaneous, authentic, and indisputable account of exchanges is kept, and as such, the intrinsic value of the material is of no consequence whatever, except as a guarantee of the authenticity of the counters. If such authenticity could be attained by any other means than the intrinsic value of the materials, the object of these counters would be equally well attained. The use of mere lumps of gold and silver, in whatever shape, in exchange for other commodities, is simply barbarous barter, not civilized commerce. The use of a well-authenticated paper currency would render possible a much-needed increase in the volume of the world's currency. The great amelioration in the condition of the people of Europe, which took place in the 16th and was still taking place in the 17th century, was attributed by every philosophical man to the increase of the volume of currency by the influx of gold and silver from America. Buyers, whether of merchandise or human labour, grumbled at the rising prices, but a gleam of prosperity was taking the place of the night of abject poverty among the common people. It was not the natural utility of gold and silver that did the good work, for as metals they minister little to man's needs. It was their artificial value as counters in a game which could not well or briskly go on without counters. But men were in danger of overlooking, and did overlook, the fact that this value was artificial, and deluded themselves with the idea that it was natural. They made a fetish of gold, a master, not a servant, of society. Morton decided to make a radical change in the denominations of the currency. He had often noted the cumbrousness of accounts in English currency, and the labour of making calculations in it, owing to the irregular ratio of the denominations to each other. He conceived that a currency in which the denominations bore a decimal ratio to each other would render calculations in money infinitely easier. Then, too, the English pound was too large for a unit, and the shilling was too small. There was in circulation in European commerce a silver coin called in Dutch and Spanish thaler, in English dollar. Its value was somewhat less than that of the English crown or five-shilling piece. This was a convenient size for a unit, and Morton adopted it as such. The tenth of it he called dima, from the Latin decima, and the hundredth part cent, from centum. Morton thought pieces of paper currency of less than half a dollar would be inconvenient, while, as the monetary transactions of the colony were not large, a $5 bill would be the largest needed, with $1 and $2 pieces between the extremes. Before leaving Europe for the last time, he had made arrangements to have plates engraved for printing bills of these four denominations. The plates for the backs were engraved in Amsterdam, and those for the faces in Antwerp, as a precaution against a spurious issue. The bills, in numbers as needed, were printed in Mortonia under the supervision of the governor, and signed by him and countersigned by the treasurer. Until authority was obtained to coin money, English shillings, sixpences, and copper coins were imported and used for change. The two kinds of currency could be used together by counting the penny as 2 cents, and 24 pennies, 4 sixpences, or 2 shillings as half a dollar. Among the importations in the spring of 1611 were several swarms of bees. These multiplied rapidly and repaid a small amount of labour with a large amount of luxury. Many of the swarms escaped into the woods, and in after years the frontiersmen of Virginia were surprised to find stores of honey in the hollow trees of the forest solitudes. It was somewhat difficult for ships to ascend the Potomac to Mortonia, although the river had no perceptible current, because if the wind was not quite favourable, very short tacks had to be made. To remedy this evil, Ralph Morton invented a vessel propelled by horsepower. The hull was narrow and the bows were sharp. The lower deck projected several feet beyond the hull on both sides and only about 2 feet above the water, as it was not expected to encounter large waves. 10 horses hitched to the outer ends of long sweeps supplied the power. The inner ends of the sweeps were attached to a cogwheel about 10 feet in diameter, turning horizontally. This wheel worked in small cogwheels, which turned 2 shafts attached to a large paddle wheel on each side of the vessel. These small cogwheels could be put in or out of gear, so that one paddle wheel could be stopped while the other was turning, thus facilitating the turning of the vessel. One of these boats would not only run at a rapid rate, but would tow a ship up or down the river against wind and tide at a fair rate. Footnote: I have seen a ferry-boat which ran diagonally across the Mississippi, a distance of 5 miles, driven by the power of 2 horses in a treadmill, make good speed against the current. 10 horses on sweeps would furnish 6 or 7 times the power of 2 horses on a treadmill, or sufficient to run a large boat against a current of 4 or 5 miles an hour at a fair speed. End of footnote. What gold Ralph Morton needed to pay the expenses of his enterprise was taken out of the mine by his own labour and that of his brothers. To lessen this labour, a horsepower was set up outside of the building which enclosed the mouth of the mine. By this power were run drills to cut holes for blasting, winches to raise the rock and metal to the surface, and saws to cut the metal up into pieces small enough to be melted in crucibles. In the quartz contiguous to the mass of gold were pieces of gold so small that Morton did not consider it worthwhile to extract them, but so large as to be readily discerned. If these pieces were thrown to public view, public discovery of the mine would ensue. So a building was constructed in which to lock the telltale pieces, while the barren pieces of quartz were rolled down into the ravine. End of chapter 11. Chapter 12 of Aristopia by Castello, Newton, Holford. With 10 good ships bringing over immigrants who, as the passage was free, were readily obtained by Ralph Morton's active agents, it may be readily seen that the 40 square miles or less of Morton's grant would in a very few years overflow with inhabitants, most of whom must be agriculturists. The land between Rock Creek and the Eastern Branch is mostly level and arable, but above Rock Creek much of the surface is hilly and stony. Morton intended to obtain from King James a charter to a considerable territory, buying out the Virginia Company's claim, but was waiting for a favourable time. While waiting, events entirely changed the direction in which he intended to acquire territory. Learning from a Massawomeck, whom the whites had taken prisoner while he, with a war party, was on a raid against the Nacotchtanks, that beyond the mountains to the west was a fair country with a very large deep river flowing for an unknown distance westward, Ralph Morton determined to learn something about the region and the river. In the latter part of the summer of 1614, Henry Morton was sent with an exploring party to find the great river. In about 2 months he returned and reported that he had followed up the Potomac to where it forked, the main branch coming from the south. Following up this main branch for a day's march, and finding that it still led him southward, and that as far as he could see from a high hill the valley trended southward, he returned to the forks of the river and followed the northern fork almost to its source. Then, striking westward, he passed over a high plateau. The river valley had made for the party a gateway through the loftiest ranges of mountains. He crossed three streams of considerable size but not navigable, flowing northward, with ranges of high hills between them. At last he came to the great river. It was several hundred yards wide and deep enough for large vessels. It flowed towards the southwest. From what he could gather from the Indians, he had picked up considerable of the language of the Massawomecks, the name of the river was Ohio. He had seen a good deal of fine agricultural country, but more that was hilly or mountainous. From this account, Ralph Morton determined to explore the great river himself. In the latter part of March 1615, Henry Morton was again sent out with a party, including some boat builders. They took a number of pack mules loaded with provisions and tools. Henry Morton was instructed to build on the banks of the Ohio a strong log house as a defense against Indians, saw lumber, and build two flat boats. About a month after Henry's departure, Ralph set out with another party, following the well-marked trail of the first party after leaving the Potomac. Arriving at the Ohio, Ralph found the house built and the boats nearing completion. When the boats were finished, he selected a party of 12 men and embarked, taking along three pack mules, and leaving several men at the blockhouse commanded by Henry Morton. The little party descended the great river with the current, using their oars only to keep in the current. They kept to the river every night, except when it was foggy, taking turns on the watch. They landed, when practicable, on islands to cook their meals, allow the mules to graze, and gather some grass for them. Some bales of husks had been brought along for fodder. For the food of the men, they had a supply of cornmeal and sea biscuit, using the meal first and saving the biscuit for their land journey. They managed to kill a fair supply of game, which they found very tame in these green solitudes. Ralph Morton had with him instruments for taking observations, and had sufficient skill in mathematics to determine latitude and longitude. The latitude and longitude of principal points and of the mouths of all large tributaries of the Ohio were determined. Floating thus down the smooth current along a broad and beautiful valley for 2 weeks, the party came to where the clear waters of the Ohio flowed out into a mighty stream whose waters were turbid with yellow mud. It was not so broad as the Potomac in its lower course, but the strong current told that the volume of water was vastly greater than that of the Potomac. Morton had no doubt that this vast river was the Messershappi, which he afterwards spelled Mississippi, which De Soto had explored, and beneath whose waters he had been laid 73 years before. The account of the expedition of De Soto had thrilled Ralph when, as a schoolboy, he had first read it in learning Spanish. Morton thought it not best to descend the Mississippi. The land at the junction of the two rivers was too swampy for a landing, so the party pulled the boats up the Mississippi till they found high grounds on the eastern bank, where they disembarked. The boats were sunk in the mouth of a small creek to preserve them for possible further need. Then the pack mules were loaded, and the party set out by land due northward. For a day or two they travelled through a rolling region with considerable timber. Then they came out upon vast, grassy, treeless plains, the like of which they had never seen nor heard of. The party travelled northward about 150 miles, and then turned eastward. Travelling about 80 miles, they came to a considerable river flowing southward. From its position, Morton judged it to be one whose mouth he had noted while descending the Ohio, the Wabash. The valley of this river was considerably timbered. Some distance eastward of this river they entered a forest region again. On this journey they saw immense herds of bison or buffalo, a constant wonder to them. They killed as many of the beasts as they wished. They met a few parties of Indians, but with such tact did Morton treat them, a mingled firmness and friendliness, and an overawing air of superiority, that not once did the savages venture to attack them. Some light tents were brought along on the pack mules, constructed of thin cloth made waterproof for shelter on rainy nights. Such careful provision had been made that for these strong and hardy men the journey presented hardly a discomfort. When the party had proceeded eastward until Morton, from his observations, deemed they were not far west of their station on the Ohio, they turned southward until they struck the river. Ascending it, they soon saw, as they came around a bend, the Red Cross flag floating over the blockhouse on the opposite shore far up the river. It was a sight that made the blood dance in their veins and their hats go up with huzzas. It was like getting home again. Arriving opposite the house, the party was soon discovered by their comrades at the station, and a small boat was sent to ferry them across. It took several trips to bring them over. The mules swam with their heads supported in the boat. Ralph Morton found that the party at the house had been carefully managed in his absence. No collisions with the Indians had occurred, and a considerable quantity of furs had been collected by trade. Loading these furs on the animals, several of which had been left at the station, the tools were left in the house, which was locked up and then abandoned, and the united party, about 25 strong, set out for Mortonia, which they reached without the loss of a man in the whole expedition. From the time Henry Morton returned from his first expedition beyond the mountains, the governor began to change his plans as to the territory he should acquire by charter, and his determination was fixed by what he saw on his long journey. At first he intended to obtain a charter for the territory bounded on the east by the Chesapeake Bay, on the north by the 40th parallel, and on the south and west by the Potomac. But he reflected that this region was too much exposed to observation from England. He wished to make radical changes in government, and needed a degree of independence he could not have under the eye of King and Parliament, and exposed to their interference. He thought it quite probable that sometime he might have to make forcible resistance to royal or parliamentary interference, and he did not wish for his theatre a region exposed to the broadsides of the Royal Navy. He determined at last that the bulk of his new nation should lie beyond the mountains, where he could veil his operations from the jealous powers of England. One port he wanted, accessible from the ocean. Mortonia was just the place. The water was deep enough, but the channel so narrow that batteries on the shore could defend the place against a navy. He would acquire a narrow belt of land along the Potomac from Mortonia to the river's source, which would afford a pathway from the port to his transmontane realm. There was something in the idea of establishing this empire in the heart of the great virgin continent which appealed so strongly to the ardent imagination of Ralph Morton that he did not want to spend his life waiting for the peopling of the Atlantic coast before seeing the tide of empire pouring over the mountains and down the great river of the interior. End of chapter 12. Chapter 13 of Aristopia by Castello Newton Holford. Very soon after returning from his exploring expedition, Ralph Morton embarked for London. Arriving there, he first went to the officers of the Virginia Company, and after a long negotiation with them, obtained a grant of land extending along the Potomac from the eastern branch to the source of the river and 5 miles in width, paying £20,000 for it. The company had expended much on the Virginia colony and received but a trifling sum in return. Such was the character of the colonists and the incredible folly of the officials that the colony was still suffering what Captain Smith called strange miracles of misery. Morton's grant could have been obtained for much less money if the company had not still been haunted by the illusion of Virginia's gold, gold of which they never saw an ounce, except Morton's 20,000 bright sovereigns and those he had paid the company for the first grant. The grant obtained, Morton sought the king. A new favourite, young George Villiers, was now nearest the royal ear, and though receiving much of the royal bounty, was greedy for more gold. A handsome present from Morton engaged him to induce the king's favourable notice of Morton's proposition to obtain a charter. James was in great need of money. Parliament, stingy even to the imperious Elizabeth, before whom the Commons crouched, withheld all supplies from the timid James, except on such conditions that he loathed to ask money of the Commons he despised. Morton was well aware of all this, and he boldly demanded terms in his charter which seemed, when demanded by an obscure young man, little less than presumptuous. But James, priding himself on his royal power, thought it no less, rather more, an exhibition of that power to create a vice-king in a new world out of an obscure gentleman than out of a great noble. And then, a man who could deliver £100,000 sterling of gold was well worthy even of a king's respect. Morton had less trouble in getting the extensive powers of government he sought than in obtaining some smaller matters. The King of Spain had since the time of Columbus exacted 1/5 of all the gold and silver discovered in his American dominions, and Elizabeth had done the same with hers. James had a good deal of respect for Elizabeth, but vastly more for the King of Spain, and thought his example should be followed. But finally Morton evaded this condition by proposing, as if boastfully, to yield the royal treasury from his colony double the amount of gold yielded each year by the 4 times broader colony of Virginia. James had never seen an ounce of gold from Virginia, but, esteeming himself very shrewd, thought that the reckless young man's proposal offered an advantage, and the royal trader closed with it. It is needless to say that Morton never had to pay James, nor any of his successors, an ounce of gold on this condition in his charter. When it came to the name of the colony, James was about to propose a name in honour of some member of the royal family, but Morton desired the name Aristopia, the best place, to which the royal scholar assented. The South Virginia Company had a charter for the region extended from the 34th to the 40th parallel, and 100 miles from the coast. Ralph Morton asked a charter for the region, besides the 5-mile belt along the Potomac from the eastern branch to the source of the river, extending from the 38th to the 41st parallel, and from the crest of the highest range of the mountains of Virginia to the South Sea. This range, Morton assured the king, was more than 150 miles from the coast. The American continent was then thought by the English to be very narrow, and the South Sea not very far beyond the mountains. Morton had taken care that no account of his expedition beyond the mountains should be sent to England. In view of the fact that the explorations of De Soto along the lower Mississippi and of Coronado and Cabeza de Valca in New Mexico had long been published, it is difficult to understand how the English notion of the narrowness of the American continent could survive as it did. Powhatan repeatedly told John Smith that the stories of the great salt sea beyond the mountains were lies. How could a mind at all philosophical suppose that so great a river as the historians of De Soto's expedition described could be collected in a very narrow continent? More than one English navigator had seen the vast volume of fresh water poured down by the St. Lawrence, which any schoolboy should have known could be drained only from a great continent. The Indians in the vicinity of the first English settlement at Roanoke seeing the Englishman very desirous of finding two things, gold and the South Sea, told them, with the design of sending them off on a wild goose chase from which they might never return, that Roanoke River rose in a region full of gold, and that its source was a fountain so near the South Sea that the spray of the ocean dashed into the fountain. And this story was believed in England. So many wonders had been found in the New World that it seemed not incredible that a river should rise a few rods from the Pacific and flow into the Atlantic, or that a vast stream of fresh water could flow with a strong current from one salt sea into another. The boundaries asked for by Morton were granted, with the proviso that if the crest of the main range of mountains was not 150 miles from the Atlantic, then the eastern boundary of Aristopia should be a line parallel with the Atlantic coast and 150 miles from it. The charter was drawn up in Latin. The preamble, or a translation of it, read thus: Whereas our well-beloved and right-trusty subject, Ralph Morton, gentlemen, of the county of Kent in our said kingdom of England, being animated by a laudable and pious zeal for extending the Christian religion, and also the territories of our empire, hath humbly besought leave of us that he may transport, by his own industry and expense, a numerous colony of the English nation, to a certain region hereinafter described, in a country hitherto uncultivated, in the parts of America now partly occupied by savages, who have no knowledge of the divine being, and in all that region, with certain privileges and jurisdictions appertaining unto the wholesome government and state of his colony and region aforesaid, may by our Royal Highness be given, granted, and confirmed unto him and his heirs. Morton and his heirs and successors were constituted absolute lords and proprietaries of the region, to be held under the allegiance due to the king, in free and common socage, by fealty only, and not in capite, nor by knight service. Quote, yielding therefore unto us, our heirs and successors, two Indian arrows of those parts, to be delivered at the said castle of Windsor every year, on Tuesday in Easter week, and also of the gold and silver ore which shall happen from time to time to be found within the aforesaid limits, so much as shall be double the amount of the fifth part of all gold and silver ore discovered in our royal province of Virginia. End quote. Morton's proprietorship was of the soil, mines, forests, waters, and the fish in them. Morton was to have in the province religious power, quote, as any bishop of Durham within the bishopric or county palatine of Durham, end quote, which was certainly extensive enough. Morton and his heirs and successors were given power to make laws, with the advice, assent, and approbation of the freemen of the province, or their delegates or deputies, and ordinances for cases of emergency. Quote, so, nevertheless, that the laws and ordinances aforesaid be consonant to reason, and be not repugnant or contrary to, but, so far as conveniently may be, agreeable to the laws, statutes, customs, and rights of this our kingdom of England. End quote. Owing to the dangers which might suddenly arise in so remote a province from savages, pirates, and other enemies, Morton, his successors, and their lieutenants were to have power to exercise martial law and military power, quote, as full and unrestrained as any captain general of an army hath or ever hath had. End quote. To facilitate the peopling of the province, it was provided that all persons, except those expressly forbidden, should be free to emigrate to the province. The inhabitants of the province were to have all the privileges and rights of the subjects residing in England. They were to have the right to trade with all nations, and were to be burdened with no more customs duties than the other subjects of the Kingdom of England. Morton was to have power to establish ports of entry and levy import duties. Morton and his heirs were to have power to convey, quote, what estate of inheritance soever, in fee simple or fee tail or otherwise, as to them shall seem expedient, end quote. He was empowered to coin money of gold, silver, and copper, the gold and silver coins to be of the same fineness as those of the English mint. He was empowered to grant titles of nobility, provided they were not the same as the titles of any of the nobility of Great Britain or Ireland. It was provided that the new province should not be held or reputed a part of or subordinate to the land of Virginia, or any other colony already transported, or thereafter to be transported. It may well be supposed that when Ralph Morton gazed upon the fair and ample parchment with its broad red seal, giving him such vast, almost royal powers, his heart swelled with exultation. End of chapter 13.